I can get you guys to stand up. We're just going to start the service off by lifting the name of our God. So let's praise Him together.
Song, we're going to do communion. So if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, we ask that you partake with us. So you can go to the table nearest your section. If you're in the center, towards the center, you can come up front, or if you're on the side, you can go to the table. Grab a stack pair of cups and then go back around to your seat, and we'll all take communion together after this next song.
And stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'll never searching for answers, only you provide, 'cause I know just what we need before we say a word. You're good, good God, to you are, to you are.
We've heard a lot about justice in the last few months, and we're probably going to hear a lot more in the weeks ahead. And when we think about justice, there's something in us innately that wants things to be right, and we want things to be fair. There's something in God that demands that things be just. And because of our nature and the way we have tried to sidestep God's justice, he allowed his son to come and on our behalf suffer the punishment and satisfy the justice that God demanded, or that God demands. In the night of his betrayal, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, and my injection here is, this is his body that was broken on our behalf. Take this in remembrance of him and be grateful." scriptures we read that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. And again, in keeping with God's justice, Christ's blood was shed on our behalf. And the night of his betrayal, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant that was shed for you and for many for the remission of sin. Drink this as often as you think of me and be grateful." Our Father, as we come to you this morning, we are grateful that you are perfect in all of your ways. And one of your ways, or a part of your perfection, is a demand for justice. And we are grateful that rather than punish us for what we deserve, you have allowed Christ to take our punishment so that we would not be separated from you for eternity. Lord Jesus, we come this morning and celebrate you and lift you up and declare that you are holy and righteous and true. Holy Spirit, we are awakened once again by your presence, and we pray that you would open our hearts that we might receive this morning a fresh touch from the one who has created us and loved us so. As we draw near, we're mindful of the ministries that flow from our church, and one of them being the support of Rwanda Challenge. We ask that you would anoint that ministry and allow the gospel to spread in this area. Thank you that you have allowed us to be a part of it. And thankful, we are thankful that it bears fruit. We pray for Cassidy Neal this morning, and we just entrust this one to you and just ask for your touch. We pray for your healing and for your grace. We pray for the world in which we live, the people that lead it, and us that are so much a part of it. We pray according to the way you taught us that your kingdom would come and your will would be done. Lord, help us to be governed by people who respect you and try to follow you. Help us to be people who respect you and follow you. And Lord, have the outcome of that be a kingdom that is established on your principles that brings you glory. We also pray this morning for the family of Ian Berger. And we just ask that you would be close to them, that they might know that you are near and that all things are comforted in your comfort. Lord Jesus, we love you this morning. Father God, we exalt you. Holy Spirit, we thank you for your presence. We just ask that you would continue to anoint this time, the music we offer, the songs we sing, and the word that we hear. Lord, may it be pleasing to you as we commit ourselves to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
We stand, join us again.
Sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in, when death was arrested and my life began. flesh was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. And oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. And it's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began.
Sing your grace.
Though your grace so free washes over. Your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you. Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you. Arrested and my life began. Oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested.
I love coming together in the church, being with one another, hanging out, singing together, hearing people's stories, even hearing your complaints. You get to hear mine sometimes, right? Just coming together, this group mentality that we have, we share in Christ. There's a lot of great things that happen when we gather together, and maybe you're not able to gather together. Maybe there's some people watching online. They'd love to be here, but they can't. And so we just cherish this community We love being part of a community where we belong that has a purpose bigger than ourselves, and certainly the church is that. Back in 1972, there was a psychologist. Her name was Irvin Janis. His name was Irvin Janis, and he coined this this term called groupthink. And it was a derogatory term. It was a term that was to describe when a group of people got together and that group mentality resulted in the hurting or the destruction of some property or some person. And we've seen some of that take place in our country as in recent months, where mobs have gathered and destroyed property and hurt other people's lives. And it breaks our heart because we hate to see that type of behavior. We long to be part of a community that is rich in oneness of mindset and love and compassion. That's what we want to belong to, and that's what Jesus creates. But it comes at a cost. It comes at a rich cost, and Jesus is the one who pays the cost. But we also have a responsibility in this. We are a community of people that tries to elevate other people's needs above our own for the purpose of bringing glory to God and introducing Jesus to them. Some of you recognize this. What is this? Woohoo! You were supposed to say Joy Box, and I'm supposed to go woohoo, right? So each week, the Joy Box receives love offerings, and our intent is to meet the immediate community benevolence needs that we know about, and then distribute those gifts by the beginning of the next week. So whatever money comes in today will be distributed out by next Sunday. This past week, about $350 was given to a family's medical needs, and they were very appreciative of it. One of the family members called me and expressed their gratitude. They don't attend church here. They're just connected to the church here through another family member, and so they were very grateful. But so far this year, about $5,000 was given through the Joy Box. Yeah, and so this is just like one thing that we do together that we can't do alone, where we have this mindset, this new mindset to elevate other people's needs above our own. I remember when I first began to sink my teeth into Christianity and really begin to contemplate Jesus' commands. And I came to that moment of time where every follower of Jesus comes to, and that is giving our regular offerings and tithes to the Lord. And I was really struggling with that because I was deep in debt and that type of thing. But I began to see that God was blessing me, and I saw all these examples of benevolence before me. And when I understood how important that was, I began to celebrate that. And teach it to other people, you know, when I had the opportunity. But we're a community of people that are elevating the needs of other people above our own. And we do that because of what we are taught in Scripture. And so where we're about to tread today is probably the most talked about Scripture in the New Testament, debated. I mean, that there are a lot of Scriptures that are talked a lot about. But Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11 is what we know of is the first hymn of the church. It's the first grouping of poetry that was probably put to some type of musical instruments in the first century of the church, even before Paul. So it's very important scripture, and it actually begins in verse 5, but I want to include verse 3 and 4 from last week, because this is what Paul is addressing. He says, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interest of others." So what Paul does is he's going to take this hymn that we're about to read, and he's going to use that as a teaching tool to address a problem that exists in the church at Philippi, because they were having issues of division. They were having issues of selfishness, and he wants to put Christ in front of them so that they might change their behavior. So Paul is telling his readers to act with humility. The word humility is foreign to most cultures, like maybe every culture, but especially ours. We live in a world of self-promotion and self-assertion and talking big and talking loud. When you try to discuss humility with somebody, it's like it's like a cow looking at a new gate. They don't know what to do with it, right? They don't know how to act when you begin to describe what humility is, of elevating someone else's needs and interests above your own. But this is the secret sauce of marriage. This is the secret sauce of every great relationship, whether it's a spousal relationship or a father-child, mother-child relationship, whether it's an institution like a business. When leaders and those who have resources and abilities act with humility, it elevates the whole group. It elevates the whole group. And we live in this world that is so driven towards promoting self. I got a chance to listen to the new Supreme Court nominee, Amy Barrett, describe a little bit about her life yesterday. It was on, I just happened to catch it on the news. And she said something that caught my ear. She said, for the past 20 years, when I wake up in the morning, my husband says to me, "What can I do for you today?" Asked her that question every morning. And I thought, there's a leader in a home who's showing humility, and you know that home is rich with this act, with this attitude of servanthood. And I just thought how different that was to hear, and she chose that to part of what their family's like. This attitude of humility that starts at the top, if you will. And so Paul knows how important this is for a group to think this way, this great act of humility to permeate all their thoughts. And so Paul is going to use this part of the letter, which is what most people consider the summit, the very central point of the book of Philippians, is this section 5 through 11 of chapter 2. Paul says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. So let me just pause right there. You are not born with this mindset. You don't get it on your own. The only way you achieve this mindset is by imitating Jesus Christ, because it's where it comes from. And so we want to live, don't we? We want to live in a community where there's no division, whether it's our family or our church or our nation. We want to live. To be part of a group of people where there's a oneness of spirit, where it's safe to belong and safe to be real and safe to share the struggles that we have. The RSV translation of this verse says these words. It says, "Have this mind among yourselves." In other words, you cannot practice humility in the privacy of your own closet. Prayer closet or by yourself. Humility is a group activity. It's a group action. And it's the only way we can learn humility is by coming into a situation where another people's needs are greater than our own and then elevating their needs above our interests in helping them. And so Paul will use the story of Jesus to drive this point home. And so before we read that, though, I want to give you a picture of 6 through 11. And this is just like a little diagram of what we're about to read, because you have to see this story. You have to stand back at the edge of the mountain and look over the valley, right? That's what we're doing. So we're starting with the pre-existence glory of Jesus Christ, and then begins his humiliation, where he renounces his rights. He's made into the flesh. God puts on flesh and bone. We call that the incarnation, the birth of Jesus. And then the rock bottom of his humiliation is the crucifixion, where he bears himself on a criminal's cross, naked before the community of people who live in Jerusalem. Then the Father exalts him to not just to any position, but to a position above every other position that exists in the cosmos. And so our life in Jesus is this story. And I think that if we could just behold the majesty of what it means to follow Jesus, like we're not only following him in our daily lives, we're following him through the whole process of our own humiliation. Like, what's your life in Christ begins with an act of confession that you're a sinner. Another humbling act is being baptized, right? You're lowered into the water. Somebody else is doing that for you. You're all wet in front of people, you know. You're like, oh. You know, it's humbling, right? Like, it begins with this, like, renunciation of our rights, right? And then we humble ourselves before the Lord. And then we're always talking about, you know, bearing the cross of Christ for others. You know, we have our own crucifixion, if you will. And then the Father exalts us. So what we're about to read, this great hymn that Paul probably didn't write, this hymn that we're about to read probably existed before Paul was an apostle. It was a hymn that the early church put together to describe the story of Jesus. And Paul uses this, probably very familiar to the church at Philippi, to illustrate the importance of a humble mindset. And so we read in verse 6, "Who, being in the very nature of God," talking about Jesus, "did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage." Christ's renunciation of his rights. He enjoyed this pre-existent position with the Father. He had, John 1:1-3 says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and he was in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Like, he enjoys this position of being part of the creation process of all things. And he gives up those rights. How are we, you know I was going to ask this, how are we at giving up our rights? I remember not long ago, I was in the auto parts store. I was getting a part for one of our automobiles, and I'm waiting in line. You know, it's kind of a busy time. And a guy comes in. I see him come in, and he's in a hurry too. I can tell that. And I got to tell, this guy's going to jump ahead of me. Right, this guy's gonna get ahead in line of me, right? I could tell that, and he did, and he did that, right? And there was this little bit of inside of me. It's like, oh, I've been waiting here 10 minutes. Well, it wasn't that long. It's probably like 3, but it felt like an eternity. We've all had those experiences, right? We had our grandchildren two of our older grandchildren this week, and they love our couch, you know, because the feet come up, and it, you know, it's all comfy. You got a place for your cup. They love that. And so I remember coming into the house, and there they are, you know, they're watching Jurassic Park or something like that, you know, and they got their feet up, and I'm like, that's where I usually sit, right? They're in my chair, right? Remember the days when we used to have pews, and people would put those little tags on the pews and say, this pew was donated, and that's my pew. That is totally contrary to what we're about to read through. That is totally, totally opposite of Jesus. A renunciation of rights. And Jesus had this pre-existent divinity with the Father. And every generation has to fight for that fact. And it's important to understand that church history is littered with arguments over the nature of Jesus. And that's why this hymn, verses 6 through 11, is so important to the early church, because it was a hymn that declared his pre-existent divinity, even though he was crucified on a cross. So people today say Jesus is a good man. They say Jesus is a prophet. And he is a good man and he is a prophet, but he's also God from the very beginning. And so he coexisted eternally with the Father and with the Holy Spirit, and he set aside all that privilege to humble himself, to die on a cross. Adam, the first Adam, and the second Adam, Jesus, are contrasted in this beautiful hymn. You know, the first Adam, he's in the garden, and he goes to take what isn't his so that he can be like God. Jesus divorces himself, pushes away his rights so that he can be like man. You've got to see the contrast here. And so there's a lot of deep, rich theology in this beautiful hymn. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant. We could substitute the word slave here. Being made in human likeness. The incarnation. Jesus humbles himself and he veils his deity, but he does not leave his deity behind. He's not void of his deity by putting on flesh and bone. Flesh and bone is not a subtraction to God, it's an addition. And he does that so he can rescue us from the hole that we're in. There's this ancient African legend about a great chief of a great tribe. And he was a very strong man, very respected man, this chief of this tribe. And there was a well that they had drawn water from. Apparently, a man had stumbled into this hole and fallen to the bottom of the well. But he himself was a very big man, and no one could get him out. So the chief took off his headdress and took off his robes, and he climbed down the rope. He put the man on his back, and he pulled them both back up the rope. And this is the picture that we see here in this hymn, is that Jesus takes off all this glory, but he's still God, and he puts on flesh and bone so that he can rescue us. Jesus, the God-man, humbles himself before us. One of the most humbling stories in the life of Jesus is on the night of the Last Supper. We've talked about it many times. It's often referred to at communion time. But, you know, the disciples, they're told to rent this upper room, so it's nobody's room. They all walk in, and essentially there's no hostess there. There's no host there, because the host would wash the guests' feet. But because it's a rented room, they're all walking in this as guests. And Jesus walks in, and he noticed nobody's done the ceremonial washing of the feet. So to teach them a lesson. Now listen, they've been with him 3.5 years. They've heard him teach many times. They've watched him act many times, but yet they're unwilling to wash each other's feet. So Jesus, one of the last demonstrations of humility that he shows them before the cross, he takes off his outer garment, he ties it around his waist, he knots it in the knots that would be that of a slave, because a slave would wrap their garment that they would clean feet with or clean the room with, whatever, around themselves, knot it in the form of a slave, and he got down and he washed their feet. And you know the story. If you don't know the story, you can go back and read that in John 13. But Jesus demonstrates to them that this God-man humbles himself to save man, and that they should do the same. And so Paul continues to quote this hymn in the next verse. He says, "And being found in the appearance of a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross." The crucifixion is the bottom, the rock bottom of his humility. None of us like to be naked in front of people. But Jesus is naked in front of everyone. And not just naked, but bleeding out naked in front of all the people in Jerusalem. The Roman citizens would never be crucified. And if you were a Jew, you were taught that anyone who was crucified on a cross was accursed, and that God hated them because of some great sin. But Jesus puts himself on a cross. He humbles himself to the Father's will. And make no mistake, Herod did not put Jesus on the cross. Pilate did not put Jesus on the cross. The Jews did not put Jesus on the cross. Jesus put himself on the cross because of the Father's will. He humbled himself. 1 Peter 2:24 says he himself bore our sins in his body so that we might find righteousness. And so by his wounds you have been healed. I think one of the problems there is in this whole journey with Jesus and Christianity is that we don't understand the desperate state that we're in until we're in that desperate state. So we try to live life by our own means. We try to have our own strategy about how we're going to do this and that. And then when all that washes out, when we keep running into roadblocks, when someone acts evil upon us and we come to the very rock bottom of our lives, then we begin to look at Jesus and say, well, maybe there's a better way. There is a better way, following the example of Jesus Christ. Because he steps out of heaven into our world to save us. I love how C.S. Lewis summarizes this section of the Bible in his book, Miracles. He says, in the Christian story, God descends to reascend. He comes down
down from the heights of absolute being into time and space, down into humanity. But he goes down to come up again and bring the whole ruined world with him. One has a picture of a strong man stooping lower and lower and lower to get himself underneath this great complicated burden. He must stoop in order to lift, and he must almost disappear underneath the load before he incredibly straightens his back and marches off with the whole mass swaying on his shoulders. This is our Lord. This is Jesus. This is what he's done. He's picked up this great broken world, and all you have to do is turn on the news 5 minutes and you'll know how broken the world is and how much in the need of the Savior there, a humble Savior they need to see. And so this greatest act of humility leads to this greatest act of strength. Do you note that? Strong men, strong women are people who are humble men and humble women. This word picture behind humility is that of a great steed, a great horse, a great muscular, powerful horse that submits itself under the reins to do a mighty work. This is the word picture that the Greek lays out with this word of humility. And this brokenness is how what leads to his exaltation. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. A famous name. A name that all people will talk about. And it's not just the word Jesus. That's part of it, but that's not all of it. Anybody who's famous can never tell anyone else they're famous. You know what I mean? Like, other people have to declare that you're famous. There's this old story I read about Gregory Peck. I like some old movies, and he's one of my favorite old people actor, you know. And some of you go, like, he's not that old. I still watch it. Anyway, he's old to me, right? And Gregory Peck walks into this really crowded restaurant, and he's seeking a place to dine. And a friend is with him, and the host says, you know, there's no table, we're all booked up. And his friend says, tell him who you are, tell him who you are. And Gregory Peck says, if I have to tell him who I am, then I'm nobody. You know, the Father exalts the Son. The Son doesn't exalt himself. The Father exalts the Son. And so he defeated his enemies through this act of humility. It's so contrary. I don't know if you might be in a situation where there's a tense situation in your family, in your business, in some organization. I don't know. There's a tense situation where you want to assert your rights, where you want to make it your way, and I get it. Sometimes you lead against the will of others that, you know, because this is the way to go. And I understand that, but it is so hard for us to humble ourselves in really, really difficult situations. It's so challenging. But know this, the example we see in Jesus is he humbles himself, the Father exalts him, and his will is done. And so I get it. It's hard to imagine this. This name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. Did you catch that? And under the earth. And every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. There it is. There is the name. Jesus Christ is Lord. There is the name that every knee will bow. And you could imagine, here's this very patriotic city of Philippi, this little Rome people would call Philippi, and all these citizens are very loyal to Caesar because Caesar is Lord. And this hymn says, nope, Jesus is Lord. Caesar might be Lord over Rome, but he's not Lord over the universe. Jesus is Lord. And so this got them in a lot of trouble. As a matter of fact, there would be many Christians that would die for quoting that hymn, Jesus Christ is Lord. I don't know if you know a little bit about some of the things that took place under the persecutions, but when you went into the marketplace, there was an altar there to Caesar, and you would take a certain spice or combination of spices, and you would throw it on this fire, and that was to pay tribute to Caesar before you could go do business in the marketplace. And you would say, Caesar is Lord. Well, when you became a Christ follower, you couldn't do that anymore because that's not true. You're saying Jesus Christ is Lord. And so suddenly, they're shut out of the marketplace, and they're having to take care of their own needs. And this statement, Jesus Christ is Lord, it's most likely the earliest Christian confession. It's a shorthand for the gospel. It's a shorthand to say that Jesus came, he died, he buried, he was resurrected, and he was exalted. It's shorthand for that. And every time we make this statement, we acknowledge his authority over our lives. Jesus Christ is the boss. Jesus Christ is the one who calls the shots. Jesus Christ is the way that I live. If Jesus says do this, there's no question I go do that because he is Lord of my life. And I would say most of us, especially when we're in desperate situations, we make that confession with not only humility but with joy. We confess Jesus Christ is Lord. But some will one day confess this before Jesus with great despair and great anguish. One day Hitler will say Jesus Christ is Lord. One day Muhammad will say Jesus Christ is Lord. One day the skeptics will say Jesus Christ is Lord. One day the atheists will say Jesus Christ is Lord. One day every single human that has lived on the earth or has been aborted in birth will be resurrected to an eternal life, an eternal life with the Father and the Son, or eternal life separate from them. But all will be gathered before his throne, and all will bow down on a knee and confess Jesus Christ is Lord. History has a destination, and it's that moment. Our history has an endpoint, and it's that moment. There's a new heaven and a new earth that follows that. The Lion King was wrong. I mean, I like the new Lion King. It's fun to watch. I watch it with the grandkids. I get that. But they talk about the circle of life. That is a lie. That's Eastern mysticism, and it is not true. The Bible says, in the beginning. That means there's a start date, and there is an end date, and that's it for this universe. There's an end date that Jesus, we will all bow our knee and declare Jesus Christ is Lord. And then the judgment, there will be the separation between those who have aligned themselves with the Father, have chosen to be with him in this life, so they'll be with him in the next, and those who have chosen not to be with him, and they'll be separated. And then the new heavens and the new earth, and how that all works, I don't know, but life is not a treadmill. It's going somewhere, and your actions are leading to this willingness moment of like, I confess him as Lord, or pushing him away. There are a lot of people suffering for this statement, Jesus Christ is Lord. There are a lot of people who are dying for their faith. One of the biggest churches in the world is in China. And they're suffering for their faith. Another, one of the fastest growing churches is in Iran. And they're suffering for their faith. That they're declaring that Jesus Christ is Lord of their life. He's Lord over my money. He's Lord over my sexuality. He's Lord over my purpose in life. Jesus Christ is Lord. He's King. He's boss. And if you do that in this day and time, you will not regret that future moment. It might look bad right now, but it won't look bad then. Jesus Christ is Lord, Lord over all. So the humility and the exaltation of Jesus should lead us to emulate and adore him. Humility, putting others first by giving up what we think we deserve. Jesus humbled himself to lead to our rescue, and the Father exalted him. And if we humble ourselves for the Father's will to elevate the needs of others, we too will be lifted up by the Father. This word emulate means to imitate with effort. It takes effort to do this. You're not born with this humility. I'm not either. It takes work to put our rights aside. But throughout the Bible, we see God humbling people before they're exalted. Moses was tending sheep, right? Joseph was wallowing in prison. Peter was weeping over his denial. And Saul of Tarsus, who wrote the letter of Philippians, he himself was blinded on the road to Damascus. James 4:10 says, humble yourselves before the Lord and he will exalt you. There's no reason to promote ourselves. Let the Father do that. And how that's done is by humbling ourselves for other people's needs. God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. You see, humility is a new mindset. It's something you have to work forward to. And as we emulate Jesus' humility, it comes in our most basic daily decisions. You know, some things about theology is understanding the foreshadowing of the tabernacle to the church. And like there's this, you know, there's a lot of thinking and explaining of words. But humility is learned through action. It doesn't take long to give the definition, but it takes a while to figure out how to actually do it and make it part of who we are. And so it's these daily decisions whether we humble ourselves. So when you come to the refrigerator and you open it up and there's one glass of milk left, right? Do you take the last glass of milk or do you leave it to your younger brother or younger sister? When you come to a big pile of dishes in the sink, do you leave it for your spouse or for the next person to do, or do you clean them up yourselves? I know some of you are getting really uncomfortable right now because we're talking about what happens at home. You know, when you're driving the car home and you're almost on E, do you stop and gas and fill it up so whoever, you know, your spouse might drive it the next day, or do you stop and fill it up and yep, you're going to miss that part of whatever you wanted to watch, or you know, you give up a little bit of time. Do you step up and serve or do you step away? Do you see a need and fill it or do you just walk on by? Really, this whole thing of humility are just daily decision moments, just daily decision moments. I remember there was this time when we were living in Salem, Virginia, and I was going to small group one night and a car ran through a red light and took the front end off my car. I mean, it was a mess. And my head got bunged up a little bit, but everybody was okay. But I didn't have a car, and so I had one car left. And you know, some of you know what I'm talking about, where you have multiple cars, like you have a fleet, just so when one's down, you can pull another one back out, you know. And so I think I got in my wife's car. I'm pretty sure I did. And I drove to small group that night, and I had a little bandage here on my head where I cut my head. And there was this new brother in Christ there. His name was Mike. And Mike said, "What happened?" You know, and I told him, and Mike says, "Hey, I got an extra car." His mother had passed away several months before, and he gave me her car. He didn't need it, and he just gave it to me. It was an act of humility to meet another person's needs. I didn't expect that. I didn't even know about that. But I thought, this guy gets it. This guy gets it. It grieves me when people don't grasp this idea of humility, because I feel like I have failed. I feel like we have not talked about servanthood and humility enough. Somehow we need to get the pride out of our lives, which destroys every one of your relationships, which will destroy everyone's relationship with the Lord. And we have to get our mindset on this Christ-like humility that really comes through these action steps. So we've been in this series, we've been talking about being cross-formed. And how I want to close this is I think one of the greatest motivators to humility is gratitude of who Jesus is in our life. Okay? So Jesus, though he was rich, he became poor. Though he was all-powerful, he became weak. Though he was the giver of life, he gave his life. He had dinner with sinners. He hugged lepers. He rescued the demon-possessed. Adore him. Have a regular time of worship in your life every day. Learn to adore Jesus. You can't study enough about him. You can't talk enough about him. You can't watch enough movies about him if you're into that. You can't worship him enough. Adore him. And let me just say one more thing. It's not the intensity of your faith that saves you. It's the object of your faith that saves you. So Jesus Christ is the object of our faith. And you might say, preacher, I got weak faith. Man, I fell here, I fell there. Look, your performance is not what saves you. It's his perfect performance on the cross that saves you. It's the object of your faith that saves us, and that's Jesus. It's not the sincerity of your prayers. It's not the consistency of your church attendance or the purity of your emotions. It's the perfect person of Jesus Christ. This is what we're talking about when we talk about being cross-formed. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for Jesus, whom I love and adore. And my life would not be worth living had it not been for Jesus. And so, Father, I humbly bow before you and pray that you would lift us up, that we as your church would be lifted, that we would be known in this community as a church that humbly elevates the needs of others above their own, that we would be known in this community not as a church that demands their rights, but a church that has given up their rights so that others might see Jesus. And so, Father, we're just praying that you would do what only you can do, save us, and lift us up. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. I want to thank you for listening to this message. But more than that, I want you to apply this message to your life. So maybe you've never been immersed into Christ. We have a baptistry. We have towels. We'd love to see you commit that first act of humility, be baptized into Jesus, begin that walk. You don't have to know a lot other than this, that you need Jesus and you want him as your Lord and Savior. That's all that's required. And just keep moving forward. Maybe you need to have a discussion about being humble in a relationship at home, or maybe there's some issue that you're just really struggling with and you're like, how do I bring all this together, preacher? Well, I'd love to talk to you about that. And we'll have some minutes to begin that discussion. But right now we're going to worship. We're going to adore him one more time.
We stand. Join us again. Let's commit ourselves to lifting the name of our God.
That never fails, will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. In the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will. Count on one thing, the same God who never fails.
forgotten his grace.